أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط صدق الله العظيم.
الحمد لله الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على افضلهم وخاتم النبيين محمد الامين وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين اما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى كما ورد في سورة الاعراف اعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والى مدين اخاهم شعيبا قال يا قوم اعبدوا الله ما لكم من اله غيره قد جاءتكم بينة من ربكم فأوفوا الكيل والميزان ولا تبخسوا الناس أشياءهم ولا تفسدوا في الأرض بعد إصلاحها ذلكم خير لكم إن كنتم مؤمنين صدق الله العظيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي اللهم ربنا الهمنا رشدنا واعذنا من شرور انفسنا اللهم ارنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وارنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم ربنا انس وحشتنا في قبورنا وارحمنا بالقران العظيم اللهم ارحمنا بالقران العظيم اللهم اجعله لنا اماما ونورا وهدى ورحمه اللهم ذكرنا منهما نسينا وعلمنا منهما جهلنا وارزقنا تلاوته آناء الليل وآناء النهار واجعله لنا حجة يا رب العالمين آمين. Dear brothers and sisters and sons and daughters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. By the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we had completed our study of 84 ayat of Surah Al-A'raf last night. And today we are beginning with ayat number 85. But before I proceed further, let me share with you a few points about the pair relationship among the Bakki surahs of the Qur'an. And I told you in the very beginning, most of the surahs of the Qur'an are in the form of pairs. وَمِن كُلِّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقْنَا زَوْجَيْنِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ This has been a usual rule with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, creating everything in pairs. Although it's a disputable issue whether Qur'an is also a creation or not, but this rule seems to be so categorical that it applies to the surahs of the Qur'an also. Surahs are in pairs. Now what are the main features of the relationship of pair among the Makki surahs? Number one point, and that is easily explained, if you keep before you two basic and fundamental terms of the Qur'an. At-tazkir بِعَلَاءِ اللَّهِ التَّذْكِيرِ بِأَيَّامِ اللَّهِ Admonishing people with reference to the blessings of Allah, His creative activity, the manifestations of His attributes, all these things you know. And the second is التَّذْكِيرِ بِأَيَّامِ اللَّهِ You may call them generally lessons from history. But Ayyamillah, in Quranic terminology, it denotes the very big events which happened during the course of history when whole nations were exterminated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whole people of Nuh, whole people of Hud, whole people of Saleh, both the big townships of Sodom and Amorah, destroyed, annihilated, exterminated. Ayyamullah, they are the very big and mighty days of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you will find in one surah of that pair that it will be devoted more to tazkir bi alaillah, Allah's blessings, Allah's creations, Allah's signs in this universe, in the heavens, in the earth, and so on. And in the other surah, At-Tazkir bi ayyamillah. You'll find this, you know, in Suratul Anam, we didn't have any mention of such incidents. 20 sections, 165 ayat, no mention of what happened to people of Nuh, or to Hud, or to people of Saleh, or to those cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, etc., etc. And here in Suratul Araf, you'll find more than half of the surah that, you know, that relates these events. We have read four last night. What happened to the people of Nuh? What happened to the people of Hud? What happened to the people of Saleh? What happened to the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah, where Hazrat Lut alayhi salam was sent? And we shall be studying two more today. That is, what happened to the people of Shu'aib? What happened to Fir'aun and, you know, his army and his chiefs? So these are the six incidents out of history which are repeated in the Quran unified again and again and again and again in many of the Makki surahs. Second point, if you look to the history of the prophets in the Quran, again you must keep in mind two basic terminologies of Quran, two basic terms. Number one, qasasun nabiyyin, the stories of prophets. These stories relate mostly to the personal virtues of the prophets. Not in that way that a messenger was sent and the nation rejected him and the nation was exterminated. Not in that way. Qasasun nabiyyin. You will read, you know, in whole surah of Surah Yusuf, 13 sections, a very detailed history of Hazrat Yusuf. But nowhere any mention that he claimed and he demanded, believe me, obey me, or you will be exterminated. Nothing of the sort. But his character, soundness of his character, that is being discussed. So this is Qasasun Nabiyyin. And the second, I told you, Ambaur Rusul, which I have already explained. The messengers sent to people, nations, they rejected and they were exterminated. So Qasasun Nabiyyin is something else, and Ambaur Rusul is something else. Now, if you come to Suratul Araf, as I told you in Suratul Anam, it's totally At-Tazkir bi Alaillah, and only a mention of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. But his personal character, his virtues, but nothing of that sort, nothing, no mention of any Ambaullah. And as compared to that, we find in Suratul Araf, as I told you, more than half of the whole surah that is occupied by these Ambaul Rusul. But in addition to this, we find in Araf, Suratul Araf especially, lessons from the history. In the beginning, we find the beginning of human race or mankind and the end that will happen to it. In the very beginning, the story of Adam and Iblis. That was the beginning of the human history. In the end, what will happen to them? The humans in the hereafter. Ashabul Jannah, Ashabul Araf, Ashabul Nar. Their conversations. Wanada ashabul nari ashabul jannah. Wanada ashabul araf. And so on. So that was the beginning and this is the end. Beginning, story of Iblis and Adam. And what will happen in the hereafter. In between is the history. Qasasun Nabiyyin and Ambaur Rusul, both in between them. And then we find, you know, that we have six Ambaur Rusul in this surah. But about this, you know, there is a very beautiful division. As I told you, the geographical background, that Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, he is said to be the second Adam. Because the whole progeny of Hazrat Adam alayhi salam was annihilated. And actually what now We find humanity on this globe. It's all progeny of Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. Because actually the habitation of this planet till that time was only limited to that area which we today call the Kurdistan. Part of it in Turkey, part of it in Iraq, part of it in Iran. And you know, this is the region. And from here, three sons of Hazrat Nuh alayhi salam and their progenies. One son, Sam. The Semitic nations, they belong to the progeny of Sam alayhi salatu wasalam. They went down from that to the Arabian Peninsula, Iraq, and then the Arabian Peninsula. The progeny of Hazrat Yafis alayhi salam, they crossed over the central mountain of central mountainous range of Asia, and after crossing the range, eastward and westward, towards China, Mongolia, and then to Europe, you know, Russia and Europe. They are the progeny of Hazrat Yafis. In between was the progeny of Hazrat Sam, Hazrat Ham. Eastwards, Iran, Indo-Pakistan. Westwards, Egypt, and you know, these countries. So that is the distribution of the progeny of Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. Now Quran Majeed is giving us the history of only the progeny of Sam. Hazrat Ibrahim was also from among the progeny of Sam. Hazrat Hud also, Qawm Ad, Qawm Saleh, all these were the Semitic races, the Semitic tribes, you know, which were inhabiting Iraq or the Arabian Peninsula. And among these we find six are mentioned. Three we may call them pre-Abrahamic area. Now this is another aspect you must keep. The time and space complex which is in the background. When we are reading the news of the messengers of Allah and the history of messengers of Allah, you must have it. In the background, the time and space, you know, geographical background, historical background, what was the time framework. So actually human history as we have been able to know up till now doesn't go beyond 5,000 years. And nearly that is the time when Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam appeared in the Chaldean Empire, which is Iraq of today. The Ur city, which was the headquarter of that empire, Hazrat Ibrahim was born there. Now before Hazrat Ibrahim, Hazrat Nuh alayhi salam, Hazrat Hud alayhi salam, Hazrat Saleh alayhi salam, these three are pre-Abrahamic era. And I count Hazrat Lut also, although he is a contemporary of Hazrat Ibrahim, he was a nephew of Hazrat Ibrahim, but because there was one generation gap, Ibrahim was the uncle, Lut was the nephew. So we can say that Ibrahim and Shu'aib and Moses, Musa, alayhi salatu wasalam, they are post-Abrahamic era of human history. That is why I think, as far as I have studied, I have not studied by the Old Testament thoroughly, but we don't find any mention of Hazrat Hud and Hazrat Saleh in Bible. Only the prophets who came to the progeny of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. And before Ibrahim, Hazrat Nuh alayhi salam, because he belonged to a progeny of Hazrat Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam. But Quran is giving us, you know, three nations before Ibrahim. Three nations, as I told you, may be said to be post-Abrahamic. Now what's the difference, basic difference? Whenever you read in Quran the reference about the people of Nuh, people of Hud, people of Saleh, only one thing is mentioned, and that was shirk. Nothing else. What does it mean? That the human culture and social order had not developed up till to a level where other perversions, you know, could be found. Only the Ummul Khabais, the mother of all the misguidance, and there's a shirk. So you'll find always Hazrat Nuh alayhi salam calling his people, La tushriku billah. Hazrat Hud, La tushriku billah. Hazrat Saleh, La tushriku billah. So there was only one thing, and that was shirk. But in post-Abrahamic era, we find number one, Hazrat Lut, social perversion, sexual perversion, which cuts at the root of human society, social order. Approaching men lustfully and to have their sexual desire gratified with men. Sodomy, they call it sodomy. Today you have a better word, more respectable, homosexuality. You know, because they have changed the word, so that it shouldn't appear so bad. Sodomy, and note here please, sodomy is a better word than what we use in Urdu or Arabic, lavatat. Lavatat, you know, it denotes to the name of a prophet of Allah, Lut. And prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his name shouldn't be degraded by using his word in this term, lavatat, no, sodomy. That relates to Sodom, the city where Hazrat Lut alayhi salatu wasalam used to live, Sodom. So sodomy is a better word, never use lavatat. Anyhow, so this was the perversion in the sexual behavior of man. And you will find about the people to whom Hazrat Shuaib alayhi salam was sent, their financial malpractices started. Cheating people. Not bearing the full when you are selling something by bearing. Not giving full when you are weighing it out. And so on. These were now the economic malpractices. And number three, in the case of Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, political suppression and oppression of a nation by another nation. The Bani Israel were oppressed by the people of Pharaoh. So these are the three things. The politico-socio-economic system of man. Either, you know, the social order is disrupted. And this is disrupted when the balance between man and woman and the relationship between man and woman is disturbed. Or financial or economic crisis, which comes out from, you know, this economic disorders. And third is political oppression and discrimination and so on. So these are a few, and we shall find here, you know, that the mention of people of Nuh in one section, one ruku, people of Hud in one section. In the same way, all these five, they have been allocated only one section each in this surah. But about Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, full 10 sections. Very detailed mention. Why? Actually, this was a preamble. Because as I told you, these two surahs, Suratul Anam and Suratul Araf, they were revealed just before Hijrah. Now, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam and his companions were to move to Medina. And there was to come the direct contact with the Jews. So it is actually a preface of that direct, you know, address to the Jews, which we find in Suratul Baqarah. And incidentally, they are also 10 sections of Suratul Baqarah. And in the same way, you'll find full 10 sections of Suratul Araf that they are dedicated to the history of Moses alayhi salatu wasalam and his people, the Bani Israel. With these few points, you know, let me start and begin the study of the text. وَإِلَىٰ مَدْيَنَ أَخَاهُمْ شُعَيْبًا. And we sent to Madian. Now, who were Madian? Very few people know that they were also a branch of the progeny of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam. Hazrat Ibrahim married Hazrat Sarah. There was no issue for a very long time. Then, you know, Allah gave him first son through Hajra alayhi salatu wasalam, Ismail. Then Hazrat Sarah also got a son. He was Hazrat Ishaq. From Hazrat Ishaq, they started this line, you know, Yaqub, and then the Bani Israel, the whole history. From Ismail, the people in Arabia, these Quraysh, in whom Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was raised. But Hazrat Ibrahim had another wives also. There was one wife called Qatura. And the line, you know, of progeny of Ibrahim through Qatura is called Bani Qatura. And in them, you know, this was a branch of the progeny of Ibrahim. And in them, you know, Midian was one of the sons of Qatura. And they settled, you know, in the area on the eastern side of the Gulf of Aqaba. This was the area, you know, where these people were living. And this area, region is also called Madian or Midian. And the tribe was also called Madian or Midian. And among this tribe, you know, one of that tribe from their own brethren, Hazrat Shu'aib, you know, was selected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and appointed as messenger to them. وَإِلَىٰ مَدْيَنَ أَخَاهُمْ شُعَيْبًا قَالَ يَا قَوْمِ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَٰهٍ غَيْرُهُ. He also said the same thing. Oh my people, you do worship to Allah only, love Him only, obey Him only, serve Him only. Don't take any other God besides Allah. مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَٰهٍ غَيْرُهُ. You don't have any God except Him. قَدْ جَاتْكُمْ بَيِّنَةٌ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. To you, a clear proof and sign has come from your Lord. What is this bayyana? I quoted last night the ayah from the beginning of Surah Al-Bayyana. لَمْ يَكُنِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ وَالْمُشْرِكِينَ مُنْفَكِّينَ حَتَّى تَاتِيَهُمُ الْبَيِّنَةُ. And what is that bayyana? رَسُولٌ مِّنَ اللَّهِ يَتْلُو صُحُفًا مُطَهَّرَةً فِيهَا كُتُبٌ قَيِّمَةٌ. So he is referring to himself that this is bayyana. A messenger has been appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to call you to the right path. فَأَوْفُوا الْكَيْلَ وَالْمِيزَانَ. Now, in addition to their shirk, he is criticizing his people for these financial malpractices in business, in dealing. So you must complete the measure. And you when you are weighing for people, you should give full weight. وَلَا تَبْخَسُ النَّاسَ أَشْيَاهُمْ. Don't deprive people of their things. وَلَا تُسْدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ بَعْدَ إِسْلَاحِهَا. And don't be mischief mongers in this earth after its reformation. Because after every messenger, some era was of reformation. When the people of Nuh, they were destroyed, now the nations which arose from the progeny of Nuh for some time, they were reformed. They were only worshipping one Allah. But you know, later on, Shaitan, he led them astray. Then a messenger was sent. Then the people of Hud were destroyed, but then people who were saved, from them you know, another nation you started, and for some time they were on the right path. So this has been happening after every messenger of Allah, that for some time the people used to be on the right path. وَلَا تُفْسِدُوا الْأَرْضَ وَلَا تُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ بَعْدَ إِصْلَاحِهَا ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. This is good for you, only if you believe. وَلَا تَقْعُدُوا بِكُلِّ صِرَاطٍ. Don't sit on, in wait, on every road. تُوْعِدُونَ وَتَصُدُّونَ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. Threatening the people and barring them from the way of Allah. مَنْ آمَنَ بِهِ تَبْغُونَهَا عِوَجًا. Whosoever believes in Allah, you want to distort for him his religion. You want to bring about crookedness in it. وَذْكُرُوا إِذْ أَنْتُمْ قَلِيلًا. Just remember when you were very small in number. فَكَسَّرَكُمْ. He multiplied you in numbers. وَانْظُرُوا كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. And you should see what had been happening and what had been the end of the mischief mongers. You must remember what happened to the people of Saleh. They were not very far off from that place. The northwestern, you know, corner of the Arabian Peninsula. And the east coast of Khalid Aqaba, they are very close to each other. So in the same way, they knew the history of Aad also. They knew what happened to the cities of Gomorrah and Sodom, that was also not very far off, on the banks of the Dead Sea. These big townships were situated and they were destroyed. So, فَانْظُرُوا كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الْمُفْسِدِينَ وَإِنْ كَانَ طَائِفَةٌ مِّنْكُمْ آمَنُوا. Now, if one party amongst you has come to believe, بِالَّذِي أُرْسِلْتُ بِهِ, on what has been sent with me, وَطَائِفَةٌ لَمْ يُؤْمِنُوا. But there remains a part of our nation, of our tribe, who are not believing, who are resisting, who are rejecting. فَاصْبِرُوا. So now he's addressing his fellow believers. Now you must have patience. You'll have to have the persecution from them. And you have to steadfast. You have to be forbearing. فَاصْبِرُوا حَتَّى يَحْكُمَ اللَّهُ بَيْنَنَا. Till until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives his verdict. He will decide between us. Now we are in two parties, the party of Satan and party of Allah. Now this conflict is going and it will continue. Till Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives his verdict. وَهُوَ خَيْرُ الْحَاكِمِينَ. And he is the best of the judges. قَالَ الْمَلَأُ الَّذِينَ اسْتَكْبَرُوا مِنْ قَوْمِهِ. In the same way, the chiefs of his tribe who rejected him, who belied him, they said, لَنُخْرَجَنَّكَ يَا شُعَيْبُ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَكَ مِنْ قَرْيَتِنَا. O Shu'aib, we shall expel you out from our city, our township. And not only you, but also the people who are with you. أَوْ لَتَعُودُنَّ فِي مِلَّتِنَا. Or you have to come back to our creed, the creed of our forefathers. Whatever we had been doing, you have to do that, or we shall expel you. You know, it has happened everywhere. If you know the history of Greek philosophers, that was the option given to Socrates. Whatever you are preaching, stop preaching. Or, this is the cup of poison, you have to take it here and now. No third option. Either you promise, you will keep your mouth shut, or you take this cup of poison here and now. And Socrates, as you know, he preferred the cup of poison. He took it. I don't want to live. But I can't propagate and I can't say what I believe, what I think to be right. If I'm not allowed to say it out, to what want to live? Why to live? I don't want to live. Okay. If these are the two alternatives, this cup of poison is preferable for me. So that was the threat, you know. Either you come back to the fold of our creed, or we shall expel you. قَالَ وَلَوْ كُنَّا كَارِهِينَ. Hazrat Shu'aib replied, what? Even if we abhor it, we don't like. You want to, you know, force us to come back to your creed. قَدْ اِفْتَرَيْنَا عَلَى اللَّهِ كَذِبًا إِنْ عُدْنَا فِي مِلَّتِكُمْ بَعْدَ إِذْ نَجَّانَا اللَّهُ مِنْهَا. If we come back to your creed, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has saved us from it, has taken us out from that darkness, if we go back, then it means we had concocted and forged a lie against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What I was preaching, that meant it was not correct. If I go back on that, قَدْ اِفْتَرَيْنَا عَلَى اللَّهِ قَذِبًا إِنْ عُدْنَا فِي مِلَّتِكُمْ بَعْدَ إِذْ نَجَّانَا اللَّهُ مِنْهَا وَمَا يَكُونُ لَنَا أَن نَعُودَ فِيهَا إِلَّا أَن يَشَاءَ اللَّهُ. It's not possible for us to now go back to the former creed, except if Allah desires, because He is Almighty. If He decides something, we can't do anything. But you know, on our own, by our own choice, we will never return to the creed which we had left. وَسِعَ رَبُّنَا كُلَّ شَيْءٍ عِلْمًا. Our Lord embraces everything in His knowledge. Nothing is out of knowledge. عَلَى اللَّهِ تَوَكَّلْنَا. We have put our faith and confidence in Him. رَبَّنَا افْتَحْ بَيْنَنَا. Now He prayed to Allah, O our Lord, You decide, You give the verdict between us and them. بَيْنَنَا بَيْنَ قَوْمِنَا بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَ قَوْمِنَا بِالْحَقِّ. With truth and justice, You decide the matter between us. وَأَنْتَ خَيْرُ الْفَاتِحِينَ. And You are the best of all the deciders. وَقَالَ الْمَلَأُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ قَوْمِهِ لَيْنِ اتَّبَعَتُمْ شُعَيْبًا إِنَّكُمْ إِذًا لَخَاسِرُونَ. And these people, these chiefs, said to those people who had come to believe in Shu'aib alayhi salatu was salam, لَيْنِ اتَّبَعَتُمْ شُعَيْبًا. If you follow Shu'aib, إِنَّكُمْ إِذًا لَخَاسِرُونَ. You will all be doomed. You will be in a great loss. It was a threat given to the people. فَأَخَذَتْهُمُ الرَّجْفَةُ. Now the decision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came, the verdict came, in the form of a very big, very mighty earthquake. فَأَصْبَعُوا فِي دَارِهِمْ جَاسِمِينَ. They were all dead, lying in their houses, in their dwellings. الَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا شُعَيْبًا. Those who rejected, belied Shu'aib, كَانُوا هُمُ الْخَاسِرِينَ. They were the losers. They were doomed. فَتَوَلَّى عَنْهُمْ. And now Hazrat Shu'aib, you know, left them. He turned away from them. وَقَالَ يَا قَوْمِ لَقَدْ أَبْلَغْتُكُمْ رِسَالَاتِ رَبِّي. And he said, Oh my people, I had conveyed to you the messages of my Lord. وَنَصَحْتُ لَكُمْ. And I want most sincere to you. I wanted most sincerely that you come to the right path. فَكَيْفَ عَاسَى عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ كَافِرِينَ. Now how can I lament about these people who were the unbelievers? What is it so? What does it show? He had the grief. His nation, whole nation destroyed. But you know, he says, كَيْفَ عَاسَى عَلَىٰ قَوْمٍ كَافِرِينَ. How can I lament? Because I had, you know, warned you duly. I had conveyed to you the messages of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا فِي قَرْيَةٍ. Now these ayat, you know, they are very similar to the ayat 42 to 45 of Surah Al-An'am. And this is, you know, one similarity. When two surahs are a pair, there must be some points which must be common between them, similarities. Now, one similarity. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا فِي قَرْيَةٍ مِّن نَبِيٍّ إِلَّا أَخَذْنَا أَهْلَهَا بِالْبَعْسَاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَضَّرَّعُونَ. This subject has been discussed fully in Ayat 42 to 45 of Surah An'am. And we never sent any of our prophets to any city, to any township, but we seized the people who were living therein, bilbasa and misery, wadwarra and distress, la'allahum yadwarraun, so that they should become humble to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because if they are living in comfort, they have plenty to eat, it's, you know, the natural result becomes that people go and they just forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if some difficulty is coming, some distress, then you know, if there is any dormant iman in some portion of the heart, it will kindle, it will come up on the surface of the conscious level. But you know what happened? Those nations whose hearts had hardened, they never benefited from these, you know, this which I quoted the ayah from Surah As-Sajda. فَلَنُزِيقَنَّهُمْ مِنَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَدْنَى دُونَ الْعَذَابِ الْأَكْبَرِ. Before that last and final punishment of extermination of a nation, small things were sent to them so that if they can wake up from their deep slumber, let them wake up. ثُمَّ بَدَّلْنَا مَكَانَ السَّيِّئَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ. And then, when they didn't pay any heed, we changed the evil for the good. حَتَّى عَفَوْا. They became very affluent. وَقَالُوا قَدْ مَصَّابَانَ الضَّرَّى وَسَرَّى. And they said, it's nothing, you know, these things come and go. This distress comes, comforts come, after comforts distress, after distress comforts. It is nothing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's just normal, you know, the cycle which is going on. It's nothing but history. فَأَخَذْنَاهُمْ بَغْتَةً. And then we seized them suddenly. وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. And they were unmindful that the final verdict of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is at hand. وَلَوْ أَنَّ أَهْلَ الْقُرَىٰ آمَنُوا وَاتَّقَوْا. Had the people of these cities and towns believed and taken to taqwa, لَفَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ بَرَكَاتٍ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. We would have opened for them the gates of all our blessings from the heavens as well as from the earth. وَلَكِنْ كَذَّبُوا. But they decided to reject, to deny our revelations. فَأَخَذْنَاهُمْ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. So we seized them due to their earnings, the deeds that they were earning. أَفَأَمِنَ أَهْلُ الْقُرَانِ يَاتِيَهُمْ بَاسُنَا بِيَاتًا وَهُمْ نَائِمُونَ. Now, you know, turning towards these people, Quraysh, who were living in Arabia at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, are the people living in these cities, in Makkah, in Taif, and so on, Do they feel secure? Afa amina ahlul qura? That the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot come to them when they are sleeping? If it could come to the people of Aad and people of Samud, and if it come to the towns of Gomorrah and Sodom, if it could come to the people of Shu'aib, can't this punishment come to you? Afa amina ahlul qura yatiyahum ba'suna duhan wa hum yal'abun. Do they feel secure that our punishment will not come to them in the daylight when they are playing? Afaminu makr Allah. Do they feel secure from the plans of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? From the devisings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Wafala yamanu makr Allah illa al-qawmul khasirun. And none feel secure against Allah's devising except the people who shall be losers, who shall be doomed. Awalam yahdilil ladhina yarisuna al-ardha min ba'di ahliha. Does not this thing lead them to some right path? That the people who inherited the land after the destruction of the previous nation or generation, Allah nashaa wa sabnahum bidunubihim, that as we destroyed them, we can send them also the same punishment due to their sins. Wa natba'a ala qulubihim, and we shall put a seal on their hearts, فَهُمْ لَا يَسْمَعُونَ, and they don't listen now. تِلْكَ الْقُرَىٰ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ أَنْبَائِهَا. These are the towns and cities We are relating to you, narrating to you the news, the big news. Vinambaiha, their big news. وَلَقَدْ جَاتُمْ رُسُلُهُمْ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ. To all of them, our messengers came with clear teachings, clear proofs, clear signs. فَمَا كَانُوا لَيُؤْمِنُوا بِمَا كَذَّبُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ. But they were not, it was not for them to believe what they had rejected in the beginning. This is the second point which is similar. Because we found in Surah Al-An'am, وَنُقَلِّبُ أَفْئِدَتَهُمْ وَأَبْصَارَهُمْ كَمَا لَمْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِهِ أَوَّلَ مَرَّةٍ. I told you. When you know it dawns upon a person that this is the truth, he must jump at it, accept it. If after the heart, you know, the mind, the intellect, the soul has testified that this is correct, whatever he is saying, it is correct. And even then a person rejects that truth out of his haughtiness, out of his, you know, being megalomaniac. I can't accept his. If I accept his point of view, that means he has succeeded and I am defeated. I'm not going to take his point. So then you know the faculty and the capability of seeing the truth that is withdrawn from Allah, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is, you know, تِلْكَ الْقُرَانَ قُصُّ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ أَنْبَائِهَا وَقَدْ جَاتُمْ رُسُلُهُمْ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ فَمَا كَانُوا لِيُؤْمِنُوا بِمَا كَذَّبُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ كَذَلِكَ يَطْبَعُ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِ الْكَافِرِينَ. And in this way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts the seal on the hearts of the unbelievers. وَمَا وَجَدْنَا لِأَكْسَرِهِمْ مِنْ أَحْدٍ. And we didn't find in most of them the fulfillment of the covenant. Which covenant? That will come in this very surah inshallah today, ayah number 172. When you know before the creation of the world of matter, only the souls of all human beings were created. And from all those souls, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took a covenant. أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ. Am I not your Lord? And all of us replied, why not? We accept you as our Lord. But you know, most of the human beings don't fulfill this covenant. وَمَا وَجَدْنَا لِأَكْسَرِهِمْ مِنْ أَحْدٍ وَإِنْ وَجَدْنَا أَكْسَرَهُمْ لَفَاسِقِينَ. We found most of them. Just as Shaitan has said, you won't find most of them as grateful. And that has come to be true. The most of the progeny of Adam proved to be ungrateful. ثُمَّ بَاسْنَا مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ. Now it is starting. The history of Bani Israel and what happened between Moses and Pharaoh. ثُمَّ بَاسْنَا مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ مُوسَى بِآيَاتِنَا. After all these five, which have been mentioned before, Nuh, Hud, Saleh, Lut, Shu'aib. Five, now the sixth. ثُمَّ بَاسْنَا مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ مُوسَى بِآيَاتِنَا. As I told you, now this is a very long discourse, covering 10 sections of this surah. ثُمَّ بَاسْنَا مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ مُوسَى بِآيَاتِنَا. Then we sent with our signs, clear proofs, miracles, بِآيَاتِنَا إِلَىٰ فِرْعَوْنَ وَمَلَيْهِ. Towards Fir'aun, and what is Fir'aun? It was the title of the kings. The real Coptic Egyptian kings, they were called Fir'aun. Just as Nimrud was a title. Just as Caesar for the emperor of Rome, it was a title. Kisra for the emperors of Iran, it was a title, not name. Fir'aun was not a name, it was a title. Names were different. Fir'aun after Fir'aun, Fir'aun after Fir'aun, Nimrud after Nimrud, Nimrud after Nimrud, Caesar after Caesar, Kisra after Kisra. So Fir'aun was actually the title. إِلَىٰ فِرْعَوْنَ وَمَلَيْهِ. And his chiefs, فَظَلَمُوا بِهَا. They people treated those signs, you know, two big signs. The staff of Musa turning into a serpent. The hand becoming absolute white, shining white when he took out from his bosom. فَلَمُوا بِهَا فَانْظُرْ كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الْمُفْسِدِينَ. So now you see, look, what was the end of those people who were mischief mongers. فَقَالَ مُوسَى يَا فِرْعَوْنُ. And Musa said to Fir'aun, يَا فِرْعَوْنُ إِنِّي رَسُولٌ مِّن رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. O Fir'aun, I am the messenger from the Lord of the worlds. حَقِيقٌ. Absolutely firm and free of any falsehood. حَقِيقٌ. عَلَىٰ أَن لَا أَقُولَ عَلَى اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْحَقِّ. that I am not going to say anything, forge anything, attribute anything to Allah except what is true, except the truth. قَدْ جَيْتُكُمْ بِبَيِّنَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ And I have come to you with clear signs, clear miracles from your Lord. فَارْسِلْ مَعِيَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ So now you allow Bani Israel to go with me. They came from Palestine to Egypt in the time of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, a few hundred years ago. But now you are persecuting them. Now you are torturing them. Now you are doing all sorts of evil deeds to them. Now let them go from where we came. Arsil ma'ana bani Israel. This is a very important point. You know, the basic dawah of Hazrat Musa to Fir'aun consists of two parts. Accept me as messenger of Allah. I am the messenger of Allah towards you. Number two, let the Bani Israel go out of this country now. Stop persecuting. وَلَا تُعَذِّبْهُمْ These words are not here, but because, you know, this story has been repeated many a time. وَلَا تُعَذِّبْهُمْ Now stop torturing them and persecuting them. Let them go. أَرْسِلْ مَعَنَا بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ قَالَ إِن كُنْتَ جَيْتَ بِآيَةٍ فَاتِ بِهَا إِن كُنْتَ مِنَ الصَّادِقِينَ Fir'aun said, Oh, if you claim that you have come with clear signs and miracles and proofs, so produce them before us if you are true. فَأَلْقَى عَصَاهُ He threw down his staff. فَإِذَا هِيَ صُعْبَانٌ مُبِينٌ And behold, it was a serpent manifest. Clear. A snake. وَنَزَعَ يَدَهُ فَإِذَا هِيَ بَيْضَاءُ لِلنَّاظِرِينَ And he drew forth his hand from his bosom. And lo, behold, it was white for all the beholders. قَالَ الْمَلَأُ مِنْ قَوْمِ فِرْعَوْنَ إِنَّ هَذَا لَصَاهِرٌ عَلِيمٌ Now the chieftains, you know, this was the court of Fir'aun. Fir'aun was sitting, and there were the chieftains, the great chiefs, chieftains of that nation. They said to Fir'aun, indeed, he is a very big magician, no doubt. He has proved to be a very skillful magician, sorcerer. يُرِيدُ أَن يُخْرِجَكُم مِّنْ أَرْضِكُمْ فَمَاذَا تَعْمَلُونَ Now this ayah, number 110, it is the saying of Fir'aun. He said to his chiefs, this person Musa, he wants to turn you out from your land with his magic. فَمَاذَا تَعْمَلُونَ So what's your advice? What should we do? How to tackle with this problem? قَالُوا أَرْجِهْ وَأَخَاهُ وَأَرْسِلْ فِي الْبَدَائِنِ حَاشِرِينَ Put him and his brother, you know, off for some time. And you send in the whole of the land the peoples who will bring to you يَاتُوكَ بِكُلِّ سَاحِرٍ عَلِيمٍ All the skilled magicians from throughout, from the all the hooks, nooks and corners of the country must be gathered so that they can compete with him. They can challenge him. بَجَارَتْ سَحْرَةُ فِرْعَوْنَ Now to cut a long story short, you know, people were sent, messages were sent throughout the kingdom, and you know, people came, all. بَجَارَتْ سَحْرَةُ فِرْعَوْنَ All the magicians, all the sorcerers, they came to Fir'aun. قَالُوا إِنَّ لَنَا لَعَدِرًا إِن كُنَّا نَحْنُ الْغَالِبِينَ And they said, surely, we shall be rewarded. If we become triumphant, and if we defeat Moses, we will be rewarded. Now this is the level, this is the mentality of the magicians. Moses never demanded any reward to show, you know, his sorcery and magic. But these people, they were professionals. They were magicians. They came and they said, that we must be rewarded. If we become, you know, victor, we are the victors. قَالَ نَعَمْ وَأَنَّكُمْ مِنَ الْمُقَرَّبِينَ لَمِنَ الْمُقَرَّبِينَ And Fir'aun said, oh yes, and you will be very near to me. I'll raise your level and status over so many chieftains. You will be the nearest to me, Muqarrabin. Because now, you know, I'm in a fix. A very big problem is facing me. If you can take me out from it, you will be rewarded. Not only rewarded, you will be permanent, you know, in a very close position to mine. قَالُوا يَا مُوسَىٰ إِمَّا نُلْقِيَا وَإِمَّا تَكُونَ نَحْنُ الْمُلْقِينَ Now you know, there was the competition. They said challengingly and confidently, Oh Musa, will you be the one to throw first? Or do you allow us to throw in the beginning? قالوا يا موسى إما أن تلقي وإما أن نكون نحن الملقين قال ألقوا حضرت موسى علیہ السلام he replied with the same confidence okay you throw you produce what you have فلما ألقوا سحروا أعين الناس when they threw they really bewitched the people's sight eyes واسترهبوهم and they terrified them all the people because all their you know ropes and all the things that they threw on the ground they became snakes appear to be snakes to be all people who were seeing it so all people were you know terrified them waja'u bi sihrin 'azeem and surely they produced a very big magic no doubt waqa'na ila musa and then we sent our revelation to moses and alqiyasat don't wait now you throw your staff faiza hiya talqafu ma yafakun and it started swallowing all the falsehood that they had created. It was only false, nothing else. So you know this snake, you know the staff of Moses also turned into a snake, and this snake swallowed all the snakes which were produced by the magic of the magicians. فَوَقَى الْحَقُّ The truth was established. وَبَطَلَ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ And whatever they had did proved to be false. فَغُلِبُوا هُنَالِكَ They were overpowered. وَانْقَلَبُوا صَاغِرِينَ And they became humiliated. وَأُلْقِيَ السَّحَرَةُ سَاجِدِينَ And all the magicians, as if they were thrown down in prostration. أُلْقِيَ is passive voice. Not only that they themselves bowed down in prostration. They, as if somebody else had turned them down. And it was so instantaneous. وَأُلْقِيَ السَّحْرَةُ سَاجِدِينَ قَالُوا آمَنَّا بِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ And they said and declared, we come to believe in the Lord of all the worlds, رَبِّ مُوسَى وَحَارُونَ, who is the Lord of Moses and Harun. قَالَ فِرْعَوْنُ آمَنْتُمْ بِهِ قَبْلَ أَنْ آذَنَ لَكُمْ Now, you know, His Majesty, He said, Fir'aun said, oh, you have come to believe in Him before I grant you permission to believe. How come? You dare to believe in him before I give you the permission. Inna hadha lamakrun makartumuhu fil Madina. Now he was cunning enough, you know, that he instantaneously it came to his mind. The situation was very bad. It, you know, turned just opposite to what he was hoping. That Musa will be defeated and, you know, all these things will pass. But now, the things which appeared were absolutely to the contrary. But he was intelligent enough. He said, oh, it seems it is a plot that you hatched in this city. You and Musa are one. And you have conspired. إِنَّ هَذَا لَمَكْرٌ مَكَرْتُمُوهُ فِي الْمَدِينَةِ لِتُخْرِجُوا مِنْهَا أَهْلَهَا You want to expel all of us from this city, from our land, فَسَوْفَ تَعْلَمُونَ So very soon you will come to know what's the result. لَوْقَطِّعَنَّ أَيْدِيَكُمْ وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ مِنْ خِلَافٍ I will order your hands and feet to be cut from the opposite sides. Right hand, left foot. Or left hand and right foot. لَوْقَطِّعَنَّ أَيْدِيَكُمْ وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ مِنْ خِلَافٍ ثُمَّ لَوْسَلِّبَنَّكُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ And then I will crucify all of you. قَالُوا إِنَّا إِلَىٰ رَبِّنَا لَمُنْقَلِبُونَ They said, okay. You know, the truth had dawned on them. They have seen that Musa is not a sorcerer. Musa is not a magician. This is not magic. They knew the limits of the magic. They were experts in magic. They knew to what extent the magic could go. It was not magic. It was something else. It was a miracle. It dawned on them. So the truth had come to them. And this truth had come to them so intensely that they were ready to face any persecution. Even lay down their lives. قَالُوا إِنَّا إِلَىٰ رَبِّنَا مُنْقَلِبُ Okay, if you want to do it, go ahead. We shall be returning to our Lord. What harm could come to us? We shall be returning to our Lord. وَمَانْ تَنْقِبُ مِنَّا تَنْقِبُ مِنَّا إِلَّا نَعْمَنَّا بِآيَاتِ رَبِّنَا لَمَّا جَاتْنَا And you are not taking vengeance upon us. Only because we have come to believe in the revelations and the miracles of our Lord when they came before us. And then they pray to Allah, Rabbana afrigh alayna sabran, O our Lord. Now in this hour of trial, you pour on us the patience and forbearance. وَتَوَفَّنَا مُسْلِمِينَ And you cause us to die as Muslims, lest we should, you know, turn back due to this torturing and this persecution. Lest we should turn back, we should give us the courage to remain Muslims and remain firm in our belief, even our hands are cut, and even if our feet are cut. وَقَالَ الْبَلَاءُ مِنْ قَوْمِ فِرْعَوْنَ And so said the chiefs from the nation of Fir'aun, أَتَذَرُ مُوسَى وَقَوْمَهُ لِيُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ Will you allow Moses and Musa and his nation and his people, Bani Israel, to make mischief in the land? وَيَذَرَكَ وَآلِهَتَكَ And leave you and your gods? They wanted that stern action should be taken against Moses before it becomes uncontrollable. So they nip the evil in the bud. That was the advice of the chiefs of the nation of Fir'aun. But please note here, this Fir'aun who was now ruling Egypt was just like a younger brother to Hazrat Musa alayhi salam. When Hazrat Musa alayhi salam in his infancy, he had come to the palace of Fir'aun. That we'll read inshallah in Surah Al-Qasas, you know. When the mother gave birth to him, and then because the command was that any male child born to any Israeli woman must be put to death. So when, you know, she feared that people will come and take him away and kill him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired her. You put him in a box and put the box in Nile, in the river. We shall return him to you. That is our promise. That was the inspiration that Allah gave to the mother of Moses. And now this box, you know, reached the palace. And he was taken out. The king at that time was the father of the king who was now reigning. And he was without any child, issueless. His wife, you know, and he was from the Israelites. Wife. It is mentioned, you know, in Quran, in Surah Al-Tahrim, Imrat of Fir'aun. And she saved the life. They had recognized that this is an Israeli child. But because he was issueless, she said, okay, we shall keep him. We shall take him, adopt him as a son. And somehow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put some, you know, mercy in the heart of that Fir'aun, and he was saved. Now he was brought up in the palace of Fir'aun. After some time, that Fir'aun also got a son. So now these two were brought up like brothers. Moses was as if an older brother, elder brother of this Fir'aun. And now that Fir'aun, the older one, the father of this one, when he had grown old, he abdicated the throne. Just as King Fahd, you know, he has handed over the authority to Prince Abdullah. So he had given, you know, the authority, and now he was the reigning emperor now. And he loved Hazrat Musa. He didn't want to kill him. And now the chiefs were saying, أَتَذَرُوا مُوسَى وَقَوْمَهُ لَيُفْسِدُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ You will give them the license? You will keep them safe? Are you going to leave them alone so that they produce mischief in the land? Because what they were doing, according to their interests, vested interests, it was a mischief. And تَذَرَا وَيَذَرَكَ وَعَلِيَتَكَ And they leave and forsake you and your lords. قَالَ سَنُقَتَّلُوا أَبْنَاهُمْ He said, no. We shall kill all their male offsprings. What they will be able to do? What harm they will be able to do to us? But you know they will be reduced. We shall be keeping alive only the women. سَنُقَتَّلُ أَبْنَاهُ وَنَسْتَحْيِي نِسَاهُمْ وَإِنَّا فَوْقَهُمْ قَاهِرُونَ We are very much in control over them. They can't pose a threat to us. Don't fear. قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِ اسْتَعِينُوا بِاللَّهِ وَاصْبِرُوا Now for the first time, you know, when he had seen a vision and he had given the command that any male child, when Musa was born, at that time also, any male child born to an Israeli woman must be put to death. Again the same, you know, ordinance was issued. قَالَ مُوسَى لِقَوْمِهِ And Musa said to his people, اِسْتَعِينُوا بِاللَّهِ وَاسْبِرُوا Now, you call the help of Allah. And have patience. You must have forbearance. It's a trial from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna al-arda lillah. This earth, this land belongs to Allah. Yurisuha man yasha min ibadihi. He makes it to inherit anyone whom he likes. If he has decided that he is giving this time and despite to Fir'aun and this nation, okay, what can we do? Except to accept what he has decided and to have patience. وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ But surely the end result will be for the pious people who believe in him, who have taqwa. But these things, you know, ups and downs come to the people. But the end, especially the hereafter, that is reserved. The good of the hereafter is reserved for those who believe. قَالُوا أُوذِينَا مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ تَأْتِيَنَا وَمِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جِئْتَنَا They said, O Moses, O Musa, we were persecuted before you came to us. And we are still being persecuted when you have come to us. So that was, you know, their feelings. أُوذِينَا مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ تَأْتِيَنَا وَمِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جِئْتَنَا The same persecutions are coming to us. Our male offspring is being put to death. Only the females kept alive. قَالَ عَسَىٰ رَبُّكُمْ أَنْ يُهْلِكَ عَدُوَّكُمْ He said, it's just possible. We must hope for it. That your Lord destroys your enemy وَيَسْتَخْلِفَكُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ And then He gives you the rule of the earth. He makes you the vicegerents on earth. فَيَنْزُرَ كَيْفَ تَعْمَلُونَ Then He will see what you do. This ayah is very important regarding the history of the subcontinent, Indian subcontinent. We, the Muslims, were fearing Hindu majority. And we prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Oh Allah, just give us freedom. And just save us from the Britishers as well as deliver us from the threatening slavery to the Hindus. And we shall establish your deen. And we shall, you know, make your kalima supreme. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us Pakistan. It was a miracle. Nobody could hope that Pakistan would be established even a few months before the establishment of Pakistan. It was because we had promised to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we shall make your deen supreme over that land if you grant us Pakistan. Now Allah granted, فَيَنْزُرَ كَيْفَ تَعْمَلُونَ Now He will see how you behave. Whether you fall back on your words and promises or you fulfill the promise. And we failed to fulfill the promise. That is why the beating came to us in the form of the incident of 1971. What happened? How many Muslims Pakistani killed? How many of them? 93,000 of them became captives with Hindus. POWs. 43 regular troops, 43,000 taken captives. So all that was actually the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When a nation makes a promise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and then goes back on the promise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a Muslim nation, if he makes a promise, Allah fulfills the promise, but then, وَعَفُوا بِعَهْدِكُمْ يُقُوفِ بِعَهْدِ Now you must also fulfill your part of the agreement and covenant. And if you don't, well, you are punished. And we are being punished even today. وَلَقَدْ خَسَقْنَا عَلَى فِرْعَوْنَ بِالسِّنِينَ The same rule. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a messenger to any people, now there were coming to them the distresses, different types of inflictions, smaller inflictions, before the final extermination. وَلَقَدْ خَسْنَا عَلَى فِرْعَوْنَ And we seized the nation of Fir'aun, بِالسِّنِينَ Years of drought, no rain coming, وَنَقْسِ مِنَ السَّمَرَاتِ And the dearth of, you know, fruits and crops, لَعَلَّهُمْ يَذَّكَّرُونَ So that they might be reminded, they might feel admonished. فَإِذَا جَاءَتْهُمُ الْحَسَنَةُ قَالُوا لَنَا هَذِهِ Whenever something good came to them, they said, this is ours, we deserve it. قَالُوا لَنَا هَذِهِ وَإِن تُصِبْهُمْ سَيِّئَةٌ And whenever there some calamity befell them, تَيَّقَّيَّرُوا بِمُوسَى وَمَنْ مَعَهُ They used to attribute it to the evil omens of Musa and those who were with him. Ala innama ta'iruhum indallah. Listen, behold, their bad omens are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever comes to them, comes from Allah with His permission. Walakin aksarahum la ya'lamun. But most of them don't know these things, the realities of this universe. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Quran al-Azim wa nafani wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikri al-hakim.
Allahu akbar, Allahu akbar.
The Islamic Organization of North America, IONA, is an organization dedicated to reviving the Quran into the hearts of Muslims while bringing its message to non-Muslims. The obligations of a Muslim as ordained by the Quran and Sunnah can be understood as having four levels. 1. A Muslim is required to develop real faith and conviction, iman, in one's heart. 2. A Muslim is required to live a life of complete submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 3. A Muslim is required to propagate and disseminate the message of Islam to humanity as a whole. 4. A Muslim is required to try his utmost in establishing the just Islamic order. The first and foremost objective of establishing IONA is to assist the Muslims in North America to uphold and implement these obligations, first on themselves, their families, inform their friends, and then to invite the non-Muslims to Islam. The ultimate goal is to seek Allah's pleasure and salvation in the hereafter. For more information about IONA, please visit us at www.tanzeem.us. You may also email us at info@tanzeem.us or call our toll-free number 866-779-IONA. Join us. Together we can make a difference.